Well, I am a psychoanalyst. I have, besides my PhD, I got my psychoanalytic training. I present in lectures, and I also write. I have a chapter of my latest book. Not my book, but my chapter was called Silent Broken Memories, and the book is called Celebrating the Wounded Healer's Psychotherapist: Pain, Post-Traumatic Growth, and Self-Disclosure. And it's a chapter of different people talking about this, because I have interest in immigration, social issues, intergeneration transmission of trauma, a lot of things that have to do with torture, and because of my own personal history.
I think we should start.
Okay.
Okay, good.
So my paper is called Remaking the History of Psychology and Psychoanalysis, Awakening the Political in the Consulting Room. In a recent op-ed piece in the New York Times entitled Are Americans Experiencing Collective Trauma? Neil Gross noted that the aftermath of Trump's election exhibits all the telltale signs of collective trauma. Gross wrote, in quotes, "Norms, values, and rituals are the linchpins of social order. They provide the basis for solidarity and social cohesion. Collective trauma occurs when an unexpected event severs the ties that bind community members to one another." End of quote. Many of us have been experiencing the effects of this collective trauma, living and working in states of distress, disbelief, fear, shock, and despair, even as we attempt to help our patients cope with the effects of the collective trauma that we now share on their personal efforts to use therapy to cope. We have seen and felt as well in our daily work the activation, reactivation, and intensification of the personal traumas that shape our patients and our unique personal responses to the threat to our personal and national identity. And we are facing all this now. For some people, it felt like bad times and places that they had barely escaped are reawakening like dormant monsters closing in on their precarious sanctuaries. The chosen life that we had carefully and heroically put together is facing a violent challenge. The again in making America great again is for many of us a sign of past horrors. Memories of descendants of the Holocaust, ethnic discrimination and political persecution, patients' concerns about being deported, memories of having been sexually abused or losing their health insurance. All appeared in my office not as sticky memories, not as complexes of identity and attachment, not even as haunting regressive prospects, but as nightmares materializing, threatening futures, tragic reversals of fortune. These are all real situations in the outside world that affects the intrapsychic life of patients and therapists. Since the election, I have been struggling to make sense of my role as a psychotherapist and analyst in the new world order. How do I process this socio-political catastrophe with my patients? What, if anything, can I offer them in these disturbing times? In fact, how do I even keep working within a theoretical framework that has intended to repress the political and maintain the capitalist fantasy of the individual separated from the social and political world? That theory in which the emphasis on the individual within the family may collude with the social framework that wants and needs to keep people apolitical. Nowadays, politics is a theme of everyday therapy. However, the interesting point is that before the presidential election and before 9/11, the topic of politics in the consulting room was hardly considered. This observation was confirmed by Affel and Simon in 2005, who indicated, in quotes, "Our patients in psychoanalysis or psychotherapy rarely choose to discuss ongoing political events. the 9/11 terrorist attacks were the exception that demonstrated that the norm is not to discuss politics. Indeed, even the apolitical attitude characteristic of most Americans is itself the result of a form of political socialization that supports the prevailing structures of dominance and that bears some relation to the excessive pathologizing of human suffering in our culture. To recognize the political and social dimensions of human suffering as expressed in differences in class, race, gender, and ethnicity is not to politicize these issues, is to realize that they are inherently political as well as psychological and social. Continuing with the topic of how little patient and therapist spoke about politics pre-election, I would like to quote Jacobs in 2004. He stated that he was really surprised to realize that in over 40 years of practice, very rarely had he entered into a political discussion with a patient. In fact, he could say that this is an arena that is consciously or unconsciously avoided by both therapists and patients. He stated in quotes, "Even in major events," and we are talking about 2004, "even in major events in the world, sometimes it's surprising how little it comes up. It comes up in treatment. I mean, this is partly understandable from the point of view where the patient is concerned about their inner world and their own particular bias issues, but I think there's something else going on, and that is that both people may be worried of entering into a situation in which very strong and sometimes quite irrational feelings will enter into it. This has changed after the election. We therapists noticed that the social and political infiltrates our lives and the lives of our patients. It can nurture and enrich or wound and diminish us, physically and mentally. But in terms of relative peace, it pretends not to, and the force of our society's separation of personal and political is quite powerful. My patients and I have always understood the rules of this game, what is considered suitable for discussion in the therapeutic frame and what is not. Now the rules have changed. When democracy itself is threatened, we can no longer deny that we are political beings, because politics becomes about our very existence as citizens. We are facing extraordinary attacks on our sense of reason and logic and on our ability to think and on our humanity. The similarities between 9/11 and the election should be noticed. September 11 was a tragedy that everyone in this country agreed was a tragedy and created a bond between people. The election of 2016 was experienced as a tragedy by most people and by most psychoanalysts nationally, breaking the unity of the nation. The similarity between these two events is based on the fact that something very important had happened in the world shared by patient and analysts alike. For many of us analysts, it was difficult to hide our personal sentiments with our customary reserve and, as well, to hold back from initiating conversation about the dramatic events that has just happened that impacted us both. More than normally, our patients got to see elements of our personal emotions, fear, depressed affect, and anger in particular, though we must keep in mind that some minority of analysts did experience joy and pleasure. In parallel with the tragedy of September 11, I talked quite openly with my patients, not my borderline patients, okay? Because of a comment that I made before. I was feeling, but also my take on what had happened. I also spoke about to my patients, and the symmetry between both of us was no different than the symmetry between my family and my friends. Quoting Schloman, in quotes, "What is most striking here is that Americans are both unaware of the extent of the inequality that exists and do not believe that it's as bad as it is. Clearly, the public is in cultural denial about the vanishing American dream. As comedian George Carlin joked, the reason they call it the American dream is that you have to be asleep to believe it." Nowadays, patient and after patient describing crying, panicking, feeling confused, feeling, having difficulties to sleep. They don't know how to continue their lives. With no exception and very little variation, people were deeply shaken as if by a very terrible event that has happened to them personally. Collectively, my patients' reactions were similar, if not worse, than following the 9/11 attacks. The threat represented by the race of a new politics now came from the inside, and it was terrifying. 5 months later, the tumult had not subsided. Instead, colds and flu that will not get better, irritable bowels, a parade of agitated body have become the new reality. For some, like me, a Latino immigrant woman, I feel threatened too by the new restrictions and discriminations towards the other. I can admit that this is my blind spot, and in my work with patients, I try to be as objective as I can. My multicultural bilingual patients now bring political issues most of the time. Some of them had worked through issues like sexual or ethnic discrimination, and they have been re-traumatized by the new image that the president portrays. Even foreign students feel threatened because they will not be allowed to apply for a working visa for 90 days. I was told that one person was detained at an airport, had her visa revoked, and was unable to continue her medical residency. Some patients assumed they were expected to return to personal concerns, such as family drama. Others felt relieved that we can discuss their political concerns in the session, particularly that they feel free to spend at least part of the session lamenting the latest Trump outrage. Others revealed their concerns through the session material. And I will give you some examples. An American-born young woman of Hispanic descent comes to therapy feeling anxious. Her job has become challenging, particularly because her health insurance is about to expire, with renewal possibilities up in the air. Another female Hispanic patient, legally in the United States, can be preoccupied since some friends and people she knows, also of Hispanic descent, that had lived here for a long time, suddenly feel as if they don't belong in the United States. Following the inauguration, family lines of communication are also shaken. An American female patient tells me how worried she is about her aged, sickly father who had voted for Trump. After the election, the family got together and there were arguments and disagreements within the family. She was upset that despite her father's illness, she could not come to terms with the father's political stance. Another one, a female patient came to the session concerned about her five-year-old daughter. The little girl came back from school crying because her best friend Maria was going back to Mexico with the deported, and my patient, as a mother, did not know how to explain to her daughter what was happening. Another female patient told me that her son, age 7, was upset after the election because he said to his mother, in quotes, "You taught me to be respectful, to care for others, respect the difference in skin color, but this man who is our president does not do that." And this is a 7-year-old. A middle-aged male patient starts the session telling me his reading of his fiction about World War II and he was enjoying, but after the election he could not get into it. One of the characters was Hitler. He, being a descendant of a Holocaust survivor, realized that his discomfort had to do with associating Hitler with Trump. End of examples. The degree to which the political situation continued to disturb my patients surprised them. Some kept apologizing for being emotional and preoccupied with the new president's behavior. Others, who guessed my liberal views, feel comfortable sharing their experiences with me. All this made me question the function of the analytic space as mediating between the subject and the real. Is this what one should talk about in therapy? In my analytic training, I was not supposed to do this. But I found that the use of analytic space for political explorations could be like a surprising act of freedom. It is here that we, in the psychoanalytic world, have much to contribute in helping people to understand what has been happening to them both on an external, political, historical level, as well as what this means to them from a personal, internal point of view. In essence, our work can help people move from disillusionment to empowerment. While we do talk to our patients about politics, undoubtedly now more than ever in the wake of Trump, It becomes more important to do this so as to avoid the danger of blaming the victim, us, for our struggles and recapitulating our collective trauma by failing to sufficiently address the outside forces that are terrifying and harming all of us in real terms. How to work with such psychic and actual realities and their impact? A traditional psychoanalyst might look for how personal conflicts are refracted and amplified by events unfolding around us. One's fear of and admiration of a dangerous father, the failure of a loving but distant mother, the imaginary collapsing into the real, the specter of death drive prompting like narcissism, is the interesting ideas, and yet in my mind, what has been going on and how it affects us is real, not the metaphor. These days, this is our subject matter. Each of us have to find a way to soothe ourselves and our patients in this time of chaos. I found that for me to be active, involving demonstrations, giving money to charity, helped me feel less helpless. Winnicott's concept of going on being describes best what I feel I have lost and continue to lose. While pre-Trump life contained concerns for specific issues and causes, day-to-day life took its course in a more seamless way than it does now. I find myself wanting to take a break from the news, from politics, from newspapers, but I can't. It's like watching a car wreck. I can't stop looking. I want to make sure I see the worst so I am sufficiently armed for the terrible possibilities of the future. Constant anticipatory worry is one way of managing fear. At the same time, I know that watching and listening will do no good. One can never count on what Trump says. His diatribe is a systematic attempt to destabilize the truth, the act of doing harm and then denying the perception of the injured. This is not an environment we are accustomed to, one in which a leader is measured and thought. Democracy is an ideal, not a system, and who gets to be a citizen, a person, has been contested and fought all along. In the face of this long struggle, we need to see creative ways to hold into our minds. We need to maintain hope. We need to find our belief in the power of resistance, in the value of daily living the truth. This perhaps becomes psychotherapy with the political self. I believe that psychotherapy can be a political act, and that its political nature lies in its emphasis on freedom. Freedom of thought, freedom of speech, and the powerful resistance to tyranny encapsulated in the radical idea of creating a private space, free of censorship, to explore our own humanity. I think that we as psychoanalytic psychotherapists have a unique perspective on the impact of Trumpism on ourselves and our patients. This is a specific national trauma that is happening in real time, and it could be very instructive on the therapy process of addressing social trauma. The therapist's responsibility is to make conscious the implications of social cultural ties and the impact of social experiences on the subjectivity of the patient. The patient as political citizens emerges as a focus of exploration. In essence, the clinical setting is proposed as a bridge between psychotherapy and politics. Psychic change in specific patients could only be achieved if it is linked to the analysis of their own sociocultural ties. Davoyne and Molière believed that both the patient's personal history as well as the analyst's personal history, what they call the little history, intersects with the history of the world events, the history of global catastrophe or the big history. Thank you for listening.